you, Asia Society, for inviting me to give a talk on conservation, and especially when it deals with the city. It's always a pleasure to share the finds and the discoveries and spread the awareness for maintaining of heritage which our city requires. Now, the fountains really started as a phenomena of mid-19th or late 19th century, something which came from Europe. The idea was to have improved drinking water facilities for the people. So it was a very noble gesture to benefit the citizens. Earlier, the waters used to be drawn from the wells, and that was not safe and hygienical. So when the water system got established, the lakes and the piped connection started, there were a lot of philanthropy which was happening, and it started as a result of philanthropy that people started constructing these fountains in dense areas of where people were staying, and they were of two or three natures. It was meant to be ornamental, to really decorate the city and speak of a very well established city where you have all these amenities and facilities, and sometimes they were also functional. So they served both the needs. And you'll find them at prominent places. Some of them are ornamental and some of them are functional. So you have an example of Flora Fountain, which is completely an ornamental fountain. And then you have the Wellington Fountain, which also is an ornamental fountain, but it also serves, it has trough for the animals. We have the BH Wadia Clock Tower, which is actually a clock tower, but there's also drinking water trough inside. And of course, you had the Fitzgerald lamp. And that was what was the scenario in 19th century. Now, if you really come to our present day, this is how our monuments were. Flora Fountain was extensively painted. It was in a complete green isolation where you couldn't really go. It looked pretty to see the green lawns, but no one could really access a public space. You had the Wellington Fountain, which has been given a grade one status, but was always painted, and we always have seen it painted, so we really didn't know what it is behind the paint. And of course, you had the Wadia Clock Tower, which was in the which was on the stages of collapse. And of course, the Fitzgerald Fountain had shifted from the present location and shifted to the Bauda Gilad Museum Complex. Now, there are other fountains which lie neglected, like you have the Madhavdas Lakshmidas Kothari Pyao, which has been encroached, it has been added. It's a grade 3 monument, but nothing much has done. You can see the tarpaulin which was hanging on BH Wadia clock tower, where a flower vendor had started his business. And you see this big large water tank, which was not for drinking, but was for, for the landscape around BH Wadia to be watered. And the worst was Mulji Jetha Fountain, where instead of water coming, you had the peepal tree coming out. So that speaks, of how we looked after monuments. Now, you have to understand that these are located in prime locations. And if you see them in such bad, neglected situation, it doesn't speak well. So hats off to MCGM, who came up with the initiative of doing these small monuments as a small steps, but which will bring a lot of positive changes. And two of the projects were public-private partnership, whereas the third project, which is Flora Fountain, was completely done by the MCGM on their own funding and initiative. You can just visualize this fountain, which happens to be the earliest fountain, which is 1865. And you have to understand that when you got docked in Apollo Bandar, and when you came out, these are all attempts of urban design to create a new sense of the city. The Prince of Wales Museum was not existing at that time. So this was the first welcoming gesture of urban design, urban furniture, right in the center roundabout. And you can see how beautiful it was. There were the trams and other things which used to go, and you can see the fountain with the steps. Now, as I mentioned to you earlier, these buildings came up at prominent locations, at squares. You can see the Mulji Jetha here. You have Flora Fountain. You have another drinking fountain here, and of course, the other fountain there. The location, which hasn't changed much, except that now you have a traffic roundabout and you have a car park, which surrounds it completely, and there are 40 cars parked. So that's the unfortunate part, but nevertheless, that was the only functional fountain which we have. Many of the fountains have not been working for such long, except for this one, which was being looked after by Mahindras for the last 12 to 15 years. And I was fortunate that MCGM put me in touch with them, and rather than just painting it as what they would have done, they were completely open to the idea of restoring it, and gave me a complete free hand to restore it. And this is how the fountain looked. If you visualize, there was a lot of green foliage, so which was there basically on the outskirts. So you really never appreciated the full fountain, and of course the cars were parked. But if you really see this, everything was painted white. Yeah, that's the problem when we start doing conservation, is that you have beautification, which is also sometimes dressed up in the disguise of conservation. Whereas when we do pure conservation, we then try to rectify these kind of errors. So if you can visualize, it's a very beautiful fountain, because the water, for any good fountain, it has to throw the water away from the main structure. And if you really see this, none of these bas reliefs ever get wet, neither through the water which comes out or through the rain also. So that's an amazing thing which we realized only while we were studying it, otherwise we wouldn't have come to know. Now if you see this, you really have no clue what is it made up of, whether it is stone, it is metal, but when you start working in detail, a lot of thing then starts emerging. You can see the colors also. By the time I was doing something, it was green in color, then it became red. And I think those who have seen it in the night, there were multicolor lights which used to focus on this. So, that's the kind of aesthetics which we have. And if you realize these benches, everything was just painted, no clue of what's what there. And it's very difficult when you float a tender, what do you write? What you don't know what is behind it and how much you're going to be doing. Now, very interestingly, when we saw it in detail, you realize that, of course, there is cast iron, but there was no clue that this would turn out to be in brass. Now, that whole thing is brass. And this is what you realized only when you started working on it. This is the complete thing. This is a cast iron spout. So what happens, water comes here and then goes into four directions. This is the brass shaft. This is the cast iron shaft. And very interestingly, there are a lot of foliages and fishes and other aquatic animals which are there, which you can't see it from an eye level. But no one could really dreamt that all these details are located here in cast iron. And this whole thing is made up of basalt. And what was very interesting is, it's just made up of two pieces of basalt. There's a center line, joinery line, and this whole trough is a very large one. That would be about 8 to 10 feet in diameter. To just have two pieces of stone. It's designed, Henry Conybear chose the place. Scott designed it, and Colonel Fuller saw through it to its execution. Very interestingly, these two stones join, and the whole water then flows here and throwing out. So nothing goes wrong to these reliefs, which we didn't know were made up of marble. So it's, you can see, once we start working on it, you can appreciate the original metals, the materials, and the other details. Now, when we start, there was a lot of trial and error to see how we can clean and how much there were missing elements like these leaves, which we had to recreate. So all this was done. We recreated it. These are the fishes and the petals which I was talking about, which you can't see it from an eye level. And very interestingly, when we cleaned these steps, we realized that there was two varieties of basalt, the beige color Malad stone and the Kurla quarry, this thing, which was made alternate. Now all these things were all covered otherwise. So all these were exposed. We deliberately removed the foliage so that people could see the animal troughs, because normally the animal troughs is the place where you pot the, you'll have potted plants, or you'll have you know, the flowering plants which are put. We've kept it low so that people can understand that it's served for that need. And then, you know, the whole project was divided into two parts. One was the lead contractor, which was Jimnodharan Private Limited, who removed the paint from the whole surface of the basalt surface. But when it came to marble, this is something which this contractor couldn't have done because you required very specialized skills. So we got in touch with conservators. Intact Mumbai chapter executed this. It was a very small project. It has not costed more than 9.89 lakhs, which is less than 10 lakhs. And that's hardly any amount when it comes to such things, when it comes to the city, including the lighting. You know, the lighting itself has costed us 80,000 rupees. But, you know, with the kind of slow and laborious process, 2 to 3 months, the conservators were here. They followed the systematic procedures of removing it. And for the first time, you started seeing the reliefs. There are 4 reliefs, out of which 4 are iconography and 4 are real images, which explain you the achievements of Duke of Wellington. Similarly, here we came to know it's you know, brass. These are the missing leaves which we had to recreate. And what we did was we applied industrial epoxy paint because that would be the most durable paint to cast iron. And fortunately, we matched it with the same color as the basalt so that it becomes, you know, one uniform color. And with gray, gold also stands out. So we did highlight the relief work with gold. There were special efforts which were taken to clean the stone. We experimented with a nano sandblaster, which is completely safe. It was, you know, there was an Italian firm which bought it. We experimented on basalt. It's dangerous to use it on softer stone like Porbandar, but for basalt, it worked wonderfully. We did it. It took about 2 months to do this also. And this is how the process kept on going. The conservators followed their technical thing, that is with the use of gel, ethanol, acetone and gel, and wrap it with the paper and then again clean it. So all this was done very meticulously, and when the conservators work, they always work, you know, in the center, dividing one half and the other half so that you can see the before and after kind of a thing. And you can slowly start seeing that, you know, how the marble starts emerging out and how you can see the details. It was a very laborious process and it had to be done very meticulously in the heat and in the, you know, the sun which we have. And this is how we started getting the details. And this is, of course, the poulticing which is done to remove the salts and to remove the stubborn stains. And then the final cleaning. And if you can see that there are some parts which are missing now, we didn't bother to really reconstruct or to go into that kind of a detailed restoration. We left it at that because that is also good enough to indicate. So you can see the journey of this from here to here to here. This is how you see it now. And of course, they've applied some protective treatment so that it doesn't get spoiled because it's located in a traffic island and you have a car park nearby. So this is how this whole process, which shows you how, you know, they had painted it blue here. Yeah, these are the details which I'm talking about, the fish and the this thing, which is very interesting. And this is how it looks now. And very interestingly, I think that's compliments to the MCGM. They changed the railing and they bought a more friendly railing looking worthy of heritage. Which automatically came in here, and it's nice to see that the fountain is seen. As I said to you, this is the only functional fountain, so it always gives you a sense of delight to see it. And this is where the touching of gold gild was done, just to highlight the details. And I think very soon they'll have some maintenance plan also, which will be put in place because we've been telling them. And this is, I think, one of those last slides, and these are the people who contributed for it. Mahindra's, and as I said to you, it just costed 8.9 lakhs, which is hardly any amount. Now, the second fountain is more interesting a fountain. The first one was neoclassical. Now we go to Indo-Saracenic. This is 1894. And you can see the architect's sketch and you can visualize. Interestingly, the height of Flora Fountain and the height of this fountain is both very identical, 38 feet, which means it's practically like a ground plus three-story building. So it's a very lofty fountain, but it goes very magic in a very interesting composition of space, goes up to the apex. And if you can see, it was meant to serve that the people can come and drink the water from the four parts, and the animals can drink the left out water. So this is how this was planned. And Prema has just mentioned the details, so I'll not repeat. Any fountain was designed with a combination of two people, an architect and a sculptor. Whether you take Flora Fountain or you take Mulji Jetha Fountain, you had John Griffith who sculpted it, and F.W. Stevens was the architect for it. Now, F.W. Stevens happens to be the same person who designed VT Station, which had just been completed in 1889. And so he was more known for Gothic, but interestingly, he was given an assignment by an Indian merchant to have a fountain in memory of his son who he lost. And he designed it in the Saracenic theme. It's located in the old native quarters of Mumbai. And again, it's a fountain with 52 spouts and very ornately carved and located in a very appropriate central location at the junction of three roads. This is one of the images, just made it into black and white to see at how nearest it comes to the original. And yeah, now while you're restoring particular buildings, and especially fountains right located right in the square, there are a lot of difficulties as an architect. The first difficulty which we encountered here was that MCGM had cordoned this off, which was okay, cordoning is good. But what they did was they raised the earth level and they converted it into a landscape thing. This is the landscape which they thought was appropriate. So what happened is they filled it with 2 or 3 feet of earth. As a result, you could never see any of these troughs. So that was one thing which went wrong. And by the time we were commissioned and by the time we could execute, you realize someone had done red Agra, I don't know for what rhyme or reason, and then stainless steel railings, which were not complementary at all. Now, this is where we waste our funds, where we could have used it in a very positive manner, and you felt bad because you're removing these railings for no rhyme or reasons. The worst was, this was the house of the drug addicts. The MCGM had put a slab, because the fountain was not functional for 4 to 5 decades. That's what I'm being told. So the idea is that someone had put a slab and there was mattresses here, and these were the houses of the druggies, and they were the most difficult people to get them removed, because by the time you removed them, they came back again. Thanks to Kalagoda, who helped in sponsoring this project, they had to speak to the police, who became very efficient and threw them out. You can see the there was vandalism which was happening. Very interestingly, you have iguanas, you have elephants, you have alligators, you have cow, and you have ram. These were the 4 or 5 vocabulary of animals which was used to make this fountain. And this is how it was painted. Part of it was broken. You can see the iguanas here, and you can see how someone has just punctured a pipe just to take out the water. The elephants, none of the elephants, had a complete intact face. And this was very disturbing, because ideally water should have been coming out, and you saw this tree coming out. And you can see the vegetation growth there also. Now, when we went up, and this is very problematic, because before you are appointed, if you want to inspect, how do you inspect? How do you make a scaffolding? Who sponsors you for the scaffolding and other things? So with the help of a ladder and other things, we managed to go up, and we located this maze of the pipe system which was there. And of course, you can see how the stones were also trying to get dislocated because of vegetation growth. When we took this task and when we applied to the Heritage Committee, I gave no assurance that we'll restore the water system. And the idea was we'll restore it to a visual completion. But when we started working, and that's where we found that we could restore the water system also within the same funding, that this was the, I think, a bonus for us to see the water come out from the whole thing. Now, if you can see, in conservation, you've been taught always to do the minimum intervention. So whatever was broken, we only restored that portion. We didn't break the entire head and we didn't get a new piece and put a complete new piece until unless 75% of it was damaged. So these are things which have been done in the same stone, same material, limestone, and carved out by carvers. You can see this person carving out. You can see the previous repairs also. These were attempts of repairs. All these cow hair, you know, faces were damaged and mutilated. He's making this, and we fixed it there. And we were never confident whether we'll be able to put the water spouts coming out, how will the pipe be put inside, how the joints will be done. But we managed. Here, like this ramp head was completely damaged and there was no way to salvage it. So we made a new piece and we put it back. Now, all this takes a lot of time to find the right people. The people who work on basalt is different from the people who work on Porbandar stone. So conservation is very time consuming. It can't happen overnight. If you can see this, only the lower portion was missing and we've done that. And of course, when we've cleaned this, this matches with that. So it's not that you'll see two different surfaces. Now, these were all broken, so we had to conjecture it based on the photographic evidences which we had, and the whole piece was put back there. And now, this is where, you know, there's Altaf who's sitting here with whom I was coordinating this project. We started experimenting. So what we do when we work on a project is we try to find out what is the source and what is the layers which have been added. So we started removing all the layers which were added later on, like the concrete and other things. And then we came to this beautiful detail, and all these stones were numbered and kept aside. And we came to this detail of this shaft. So we knew for sure that there is an 8 to 9 inches of a vertical shaft which goes down. And by the way, these are beautiful brass nozzles which emit waters in all sides. This is the old pipes which were connecting to this. Now, sorry, this was the other thing. Now, what someone did was they made an RCC wall here and an, a kind of a wall here, and they put a slab and they put some steel beams. The idea is that they wanted to retain the water, but it was not working well. And what this thing was doing, which was wrong, was that it was blocking the access to go to the pipe. Now, when we saw it from the top, we realized that there is a pipe, but how do you access the pipe? Fortunately, we discovered one clue here, which is the outflow, and the other one was this small chamber. Now, I was I'll be frank enough, I've not ventured to go in, but Altaf did manage to go inside, and we did rectify this. This is how it looks from inside. Now, it's very easy when you're building a fountain because you put the vertical shaft and you're building all around it. But having completed the work, how do you go inside to connect a pipe? That's very, very difficult. So this was happening prior to Flora Fountain. So it gave us a lot of understanding and confidence as how you can really go to the water system. There are no drawings, no information. And I tried contacting English Heritage, National Trust. No one could share any information. So you can see these are the roots of the peepal tree which were growing from inside. And this is a 9 inches diameter pipe. Now, we reconnected all these things. And you can see how it's been connected. Interestingly, there's no valve to control it. Now, what we had to really do is, till here the pipe came, which is a GI pipe. But from there, we had to use practically what the air conditioning people use, a copper pipe, taking it out in a flexible manner because you could bend it, you could take it out, and these would be more long lasting. So with this, we worked the whole thing out and we tested the water. The joy was phenomenal to see this happen because for the first time, water really came in. So you had to fill the trough and pump the water. This was, a tremendous joy to see this happen. But apart from that, a lot of structural interventions were required to join the stones together, stitch it, you know, do a waterproofing, get the right slope so that the water comes out from the from the other places of spouts or otherwise, and to do a waterproofing down below. Now, we've removed all the steel which was here, and we've just retained this. We've kept a small trap door to go inside. And these were some very meticulous drawings which we prepared while the scaffolding was on. And this is how the whole system works. So this is where the gate is to go inside. This is what you have. This is the first level, second level, and then this is where the water comes in. And there were separate pipes for here because this was the drinking water for the human people, for the natives or human being to drink. And this is what it looks now. It's 2 years past, I think, yes, 2 years past, still maintained by Kalagoda people, and the water still works. The timer switch has been put, so 3 hours in the morning and 3 hours in the evening. We had to do a landscape plan. So what we did was we had a paved area, which was here, and we've done some landscape on the other side of it. And this is what we started doing, removing all the earth. And this is how it looks now. Unfortunately, this tree has fallen off a month ago or 2 months ago. We kept a perforated fencing and so that you can see the fountain, but prevents the people from not entering in. And very interestingly, by the time this whole exercise could get over, you had so many restaurants which were catering to the local there. They started coming in and taking responsibilities that we'll maintain it. And we'll see the security part of it, which is something which is positive, how a small area can transform. And you have the National Hindu Hotel who looks after all the plants. He sends his gardener, he changes the plants, and he keeps everything. So, which is really very interesting. Now, this is what I can sum up. You know, as a conservation architect, when you can get back to the first person's creation, and come back, if I made this into black and white, this is what it would be, nearest matching to the original. And these are some photographs just to show you the before, after, and the amount of pain and the labor which goes to coordinate it. We spent about 43 or 44 lakhs only for that, including fencing, including the site area surrounding. So again, not very large amounts. You can see the the restoration before and after. And very interestingly, use of granite also. So it's used two qualities of basalt, marble jali, and then granite. So this is a marble jali, and you can see the water coming in again. So 42.73, and it took us about five months, January to June, we finished it. So with this, you know, two fountain gets over. Now we come to the most important fountain, which is Flora Fountain. A lofty three-tier fountain, 38 feet in height. Now, if someone had to identify its cultural significance, I would say it's a prime landmark, which came up at the intersection of two roads, which is the the state axis and this. Now, Bartle Frere, when he was the governor, he transformed Mumbai and he wanted it to be a modern city, the best city east of Swiss. So this is in one way a symbol for that, symbolizing progress and a modern city where you get welcomed. Now, it was originally supposed to be in the Victoria Gardens, which is the botanical gardens in the central roundabout. I'll just show you in a couple of minutes. They chose the best person to do this, which is Norman Shaw, who was a very talented architect, and James Forsyth. I'll speak more about James Forsyth in some while. And very interestingly, it had a very large trough, which I'll come to it. As I mentioned to you, there was a special committee which was set up, which was called the Esplanade Fee Committee, and there was a Rampart Removal Committee. So the Rampart Removal Committee recommended the demolition of the fort walls, and whereas the Esplanade Fee Committee was a committee which ensured new public buildings which came, improved the imageability, legibility of the city, and served as the functional needs for the city. So it's interesting, you have some heritage which was being knocked down, which was the fort walls, 1720 to 1860s, 140 years. But what it gave you is today's heritage, and it's now the World Heritage also. So if it improves the city and other things, it's perhaps worth looking into it. Very interestingly, it will be celebrating 150 years in this year. This is the axis, this is the roundabout in the Victoria Gardens where this fountain would have been placed, and this is an old etching as how the architect had visualized this fountain to be. Now, very interesting changes have happened, and you can see it here. This is a very large diameter trough, which is about 100 feet in diameter. It had a fencing which was there, and it had a green open space. There are no trams. You can see there's no American Express Bank building and no VT station. And no, these are only horse carriages and other. I'm deliberately showing you because you can put it in perspective. Very interestingly, this is the cathedral school originally. And it is not this, it's the modified building, because what you see here is the building which was designed by Colonel Fuller. But F.W. Stevens modified it in 1895. This is 1885. You can see the dome of VT being constructed, which is yet not completed. As I said to you, so it was a very important circular roundabout which welcomed you if you came from Churchgate or if you came from any streets. You can start seeing the horse-driven trams which starts emerging. You can see this corner building, which is a very interesting terracotta building. Unfortunately, we've lost the top floor. And you can still see the water. And you can see the green, and you can see a kind of special paving around it. So this was there for a couple of years, not more. It stayed only for 20, 25 years because things changed. Again, the same shot of this building, which I showed you. So yeah, now this is the railing, and this is where we try to borrow the pattern which we've chosen. As an architect, I can't choose something which I like or it's as per my whims and fancies. It has to be based on historical evidences and traces. Now, very interestingly, by early 1900s, you find that the fencing has disappeared. There's no water, there's no grill, and everyone is just walking around it. So you can see things very clearly there, and these lamps which were located outside were bought close to this. Then 1950s, what is interesting is it becomes a busy roundabout where the traffic increases, mode of transport, vehicular transport has increased. You have buses, trams, you have taxi stand, so a whole dedicated area, and interestingly there's a scaffolding erected. Perhaps for its maintenance, so which you can see, which is a very rare sight to see a scaffolding erected. So this is how it changes. This is, I think, Praful Patel's shot, which he shot about this from the American Express Bank. And you can see that it's more of a traffic roundabout, the tram tracks which we find here. Sorry, this cursor is not working. So you can see that located there, and you have now a distinct car park which is being formed there, and a car park which is coming here. Yeah, but by 1960s, you can see the Hutatma Smarak has started coming up there, and it becomes a very large traffic roundabout with a lot of, it's lost its importance, and it's a car parking place, because all the fort area buildings don't have car parks, so everyone used to park their cars here, and that's how all these fountains got covered with the amount of cars. Then by late 1980s, what happens is we again have, we have started having memorials, which is one is Hutatma Smarak, then a landscape map of Maharashtra, and then an elliptical thing which comes in here, and the whole car park. So the idea is that it just now, if you see Flora Fountain, it's just left as a walk, a passage to walk and cross across on Veer Nariman Road to go to Asiatic Library. It's lost that grandeur which it had. A more close-up shot, yes, a lot of green which is cordoned off but non-accessible, and the worst is that if you really see some of these footpaths, they're just 2 to 3 feet wide. I don't know if you can see here somewhere. It's only just 2.5 to 3 feet, which is really tricky because, you're located at a major junction. Yeah, and we get commissioned in 2007. It's taken a very long time for us to get appointed. submit the plans to Heritage Committee and then actually see execution, which happens in 2016. So it's been a very long wait. What you can see is the MCGM and you know, in their own this thing, they've put a central jet which throws the water upstairs. Now, being made up of limestone, it is an imported limestone which came from England. It absorbs completely the water, and you know, the water which used to then get absorbed, and with the round spouts which you had, the moss and algae and the soiling started. I'll not go through this. This is chronologically all the events which have been worked out. Very interestingly, the Prince of Wales Museum had got a study done with the help of BRC people. And while we were working, one of the scientists got in touch and said there is a crack in the Flora Fountain, which we had discovered by that time. And they had also discovered the leaks which were there. Now, the historical research. I'm talking of James Forseth, and he happened to have designed this beautiful fountain, which is the Whitley Courts, which is Perseus. I don't know how to pronounce it, but this is the largest fountain in Europe. So they commissioned someone who had designed the finest and the largest fountain. And he was commissioned to do this. And by the time he was commissioned to do this, he also, there are mentions that he's done the medallion to the, you know, in the triumphal arch, which you see. It's not working. Thanks. If you can see the triumphal arch, it's supposed to have the bas relief is supposed to have been done by him. They were two brothers, and so again, you know, they chose the best person. And by the time he was doing this, he also got a similar assignment to do something in Dudley. And if you can see the similarities, if you can see this dolphin, not a dolphin, a celestial fish, this is practically similar to what you have here. So you can just see the influence of this. Like, this was again in the center, very similar to this. This is 1867 is the commission period. Now, very interestingly, these four allegorical statues are depicting it. They were commissioned by the Agro Horticultural Society of Western India, and they depict plant, industry, cereal, and edible oil. That's what Christopher London's research helps in telling me, and he shared it with us. And very interestingly, you find these in bas reliefs in buildings abroad. These are four seasons where someone else has depicted them there, but here you can see them depicted in this manner here. Now, this is the architect sketch, and you can see, you know, it was practically similar as what got executed. Of course, the water jet was not in such force and power, because this is how it used to work through gravity earlier. Now, this is where the proposal starts. We are not very happy with this kind of a landscape which is there, but it's very difficult to convince people, especially the administration, because we are reducing the green. But we finally managed to speak to all the the opposition leaders, and the mayor called for a special meeting, and it was all agreed upon. The Heritage Committee approved it. So this is how this unwanted green was removed. And this is what we decided to give, that more people can be around it and appreciate it rather than just walking beside it. We were told to retain a lot of whatever you could retain from the green. So we've left some there. And the most important was to see that water starts coming in a proper manner and starts functioning. Now, as I said to you, I was no expert on fountains, but by the time you did, this was the fourth fountain I was working. So you had some confidence in some levels. This is the railing design which was made, copied from this. It took about 15 to 20 days to exactly rasterize and get this made. These were the inventory of defects. When you become a conservation architect, you have to record all your defects, prepare good drawings. And this is how the mapping of the condition was done. Now, if you can see, the spouts were punctured anywhere, and there's more spouts in other places where the water comes out. You had broken hands. You had everything which was painted upon. And you realize, why did they paint it? Because when you had missing pieces and you've joined them with help of cement, then you have to paint it to camouflage it. and no one wants to look after it as an exposed stone, which is fairly laborious and other things. So that's how the paint business started. And there was a house which was looking after it. You can see the spout where someone has just punctured. The water is not coming out from any of these. And so this was the various kind of surveys which were done. And if you can see, when the water was flown, there was no way to regulate the water. So it came in this kind of a layer. So this was damaging it more than doing it good. This is how they had connected the pipes directly to the heads of the lines, which you can see. Now, if you can see this, this is an extra piece put because the jaw had broken down. So someone has done this and then painted it. And here we, if you very meticulously see, this is the original surface. So someone has added an extra surface because there was a leak which was happening from there. They poured a lot of lead and they camouflaged it with the help of cement. So when we removed that cement, the water started gushing out. So we could identify the areas where the leaks were. Now, as I said to you, these are the four statues and different things had, you know, the one had a lot of orthopedic things which were there, like two hands not there, one palm not there, so many things. Now, the difficulties when you start working on it, you have to plan it in great meticulousness. Hats off to a great team of the MCGM officials, Heritage Cell, Kiran Bhavsar, my structural engineer who helped, Altaf and others, who Prajakta, who were associated with this. We had to measure all the levels first. So that was the first exercise which was done. We had to prepare very proper drawings to understand the quantities and other things. Now, the water system was, this is how it was. And something very interesting which was not known earlier was, the overflow of this water also flew from, came from here to diagonally inside. So it was a fountain which was not just happening outside, it was also happening inside. And this is, you discovered when you started making the fountain function, and it's brilliantly worked out. So we prepared all these drawings. I will not go into the details, but everything has been measured into great meticulousness. Now, this is where the interesting thing starts. Hats off to Mr. Kunte, Sitaram Kunte, who is the municipal commissioner. When we went to him, he said, how are you going to execute the project? I said, well, we'll have to float tenders. He said, yes, you do float tenders, but you do one thing. The area which is in the circumference, of, you know, within the trough, give it to an right agency which will execute. So we approached Prince of Wales Museum and we approached INTAC. INTAC was given the project, INTAC Mumbai chapter. So everything which was done within the trough was done by the INTAC Mumbai chapter. Now, the first thing logically to do was to remove all the waterproofing which was added in layers and layers. So that was the first thing which happened. This is, we are talking of December 2016 and January 2017. So the first thing was to do the marble trough. We chose Italian marble, which was what was put here. We made the existing sump and the pump functional. It was an old pump and we didn't have to change it. When we started scraping and removing, you realize a lot of interventions were done with cement. So we had to remove them, and this is the new limestone which we had to fit, which will match and fit exactly. And had to be done in a zigzag manner so that it fits properly there. We tried doing thermal investigations, but we were not very successful in diagnosing where exactly the leakage was happening. So a lot of these things were done by trial and error method. Like we had to force the water from the mouth and see where it is coming out, where is it leaking. So 1-2 weeks was completely at site with the plumbers, we standing up and trying to find this out. And then we started investigating this. We had to go into the central drum, because until unless you don't reach that central drum, you will not be able to find out. So we removed all the later layers. Originally, you used to find only these three things, which were where you put the key and you operated it. But none of the keys were available with the MCGM. So we had to open this up. And we realized that this whole thing is made up of two stones. This whole thing was one Portland stone, large stone, and there was a small opening to go inside. So with this opening, we managed to go inside, and very interestingly, you found a lot of ink bottle, old glasses, a soda bottle, and other things of 1950s, vintage, all buried inside. I wish we could have retained it and have a small museum, but nothing. Well, having said this, I now miss Foy Nissen a lot. And Bittu, correct me if I'm wrong. He used to say there was one thief, you know, who was very notorious, and he used to, in 1940s or 40s or this thing, he used to stay in Flora Fountain. He used to go and sleep. Is it true? Is it true? Okay. So anyway, this is what it is. So we started going in, and when we went inside, we discovered there are walls which were never working. So we decided to put new walls, and we put a manhole so that we can go in. It's a waterproof manhole. And this is what we experimented, and we corrected. So we did everything very slowly and steadily, testing one thing at one time, because we didn't want to mess up with something which would land up into more problems. This is where we found the faults of leaking. If you opened up this area, you saw how the lead pipes had got rusted. So we put new connections. This is where this had to be connected with this. So this is how we identified. Now, very interestingly, this is the lid, you know, when you on your water, and if you're not regulating it, this lid used to fly up. So we had to put a lot of lead, and then we had to seal this whole thing up, and we've sealed it up after repairing it. Then we had to do waterproofing of it. This is done with lime and surki. And yeah, when you work on a structure like this, located right in the heart of the city, it's very difficult. Everyone is going through and otherwise. So you had to take care of the security of material. You have to see that the city doesn't lose not seeing the monument for such a long time, which unfortunately dragged on for 2 years. So we had full-size cutouts made on four directions, which I'm sure all of you all would have seen, which lasted very fine for the first year, but after the rains, for the first time, a professional scaffold was erected, because as a conservation architect, when you see so many buildings, including Witty Station, you never see a professional scaffold. So if you don't see a scaffold, you can understand how workers would be working on it. But the conservators required this kind of scaffolding, so this was constructed. The conservators came in the month of March, and they started working, Subrata Sen from Delhi and his team. So this is how it started from the top. It took us 6 months only to clean Flora. And there was a team of 5 to 6 people working on it. You can see them working up and down. There's a special platform. He's working on the top, and they normally work, as I said to you, in one direction, one half. So you can easily make out, if you can see from here, this thing. So, and this is the time when we realize there is a crack. And we passed a string, and we realized it's been joined with the dowel. So this had to be dismantled, had to be refixed in a proper manner. And whatever happens in an orthopedic hospital, the same thing with attraction, this, that, take it up, clean everything. And you can see the string which has been put here. Hats off to the team of intact conservators who did this. When you lower it down, you have to have thermocol. You take the rubbing, cover it, protect it well, put a new stainless steel, torsioned, twisted one, so that it anchors well. All that care and precaution were taken here. And if you can see this, the nose had slightly chipped off, so we have a phrase called dentistry repairs, which was done here. And you can see the crack which has been filled up. So in conservation, you have something called 6 inches, 6 yards. So from 6 inches, if someone climbs, you should be able to see what intervention has happened. But from 6 yards, someone should not be able to identify. So you'll not see it from, if I'm showing you, you'll see this, but you'll not see it as a. Now, this is how they were working in great difficulties, wearing this gear and working with this team, because this was the only way to remove the paint, using the steam and small tools of, scalpel and things like that. Platform where up and down both the works were going on, and these are micro chisel, scalpel, and so many other things. So one of these fishes used to take one month each. So as I said to you, MCGM wanted things in hurry, but these things do take time. Very interesting was to see the name of the architect and the sculptor located on the south side of the third tray. R.N. Shaw, London, and of course James Forsyth written here. And this is the medallion. This is what they've cleaned. Apparently, the conservators say there were 15 to 16 layers of paint which have been added to it. Now, this is the lower level. When we start in conservation, you have to always start from top to bottom. But we did have a problem that when the monsoons were approaching, we could not keep the scaffolding higher because of the wind pressures to be too strong, like what you've seen now, what has happened, or earlier there was a kind of a thing, you know, a scaffolding which fell down. So we had to take care. So we had to dismantle the scaffolding and then re-erect it again. So all these small, finer things have to be seen. Here you can see practically a cleaning of this northeast figurine happening. And what you'll find is very interesting how the face is emerging out. You can see this much portion has been cleaned. And this is much more clearer. You know, all this was all covered in layers of paint. The pointing was all redone. You can see the conservators working on it. Now we come down to the lower level of trays. Now somewhere we had to improve the details. So we've added stainless steel spout so that the waters can flow out. This is the marble in situ which we've done on the lower floor. Now this is where the cement hand was put in. You can see the hand is not in the proper anatomy also. So we removed it from here. And this is the process. This is the hand removed. This is a clay model done which replicates and matches based on the anatomy of the existing hand and conjectured with photographs and with this thing. This is a mold made. And then from the mold made, a limestone carving done and then fixing it up. It doesn't happen overnight. This took 2 to 3 months. Then finally putting it back. So if you go and if you see and if you pay more attention and if you see it closely, you'll understand which are the reconstructed hands. You can see this hand which has been added. This whole portion was missing from here. So this is how. And then we had to finally open it up. So we had to clean it once again, because every rain, you know, the mosque and algae will come in. So it's easy said that it's a wonderful job done, but if you don't maintain it well, it'll come back very soon. Because the water also, I have to tell you that we change, there's 15,000 liters of water, which is changed every week because the mosque and algae comes very soon. Because so we are trying to work out in consultation with people how to stop the mosque and this thing, the algae which is happening. But we are it's not reached a successful stage as yet. Now, these are just images to show you before, after, so that you understand. And I'm sure you've seen it. So you can see this. This whole thing was removed. So the water is coming out from the spouts. The improvement of trays, the cleaning. This is the hand which is missing, and this is what has been joined. This was removed. This is what has been added. Now, this was an existing piece, but we had to add an extra piece of stainless steel support, which has been camouflaged. Because what happens when we leave, and suppose someone erects a bamboo scaffolding, and what you normally see for maintenance, they just put their foot on either an arm or anywhere, and this will then tend to break. So not very happy to see this, but it was inevitable. So sometimes you have to do a least bad compromise. So this is how this whole thing gets completed here. And this is before and after. Now we come with the phase two part of it. The phase one, which was related to the circular trough, got over. Now we come to the surrounding areas, because it's like a statue. The statue can be good, but if you don't have a good pedestal, the statue will not have a value. So you had to do a good job to the surrounding areas, which is what we insisted. And while we were excavating the whole thing, we found these tram tracks, which we decided to retain them at the place. I think the whole city now loves it because that shows some traces of history. You can see the work going on simultaneously. There are two teams working simultaneously in it. The services used to run like that, so we had to take care of them. So all underground trenches have been made in all directions so that you don't have to dig or excavate this. Proper manhole covers are all there. So all this has been planned well in advance. And then you had to build another circular trough, which was done in concrete, but we had to go for eccentric foundations because we were retaining the original lamp details and the basalt flooring which we found there. This is the basalt which we found, so we retained it there. And we experimented a lot with the basalt flooring because we strongly feel that the local stone, which was the local distinctiveness, should come back. All our footpaths used to be in basalt stone and they were never changed. Unfortunately, our pavers now find changes in every 5 months or, you know, every 2 years or 3 years. So we went for basalt flooring. Various options were chosen. And I think the more complicated bit was the fabrication work because you had these grills which were designed, but they had to fit on a circular surface. If it is a straight surface, it's very easy, but when you have to do it on a circular surface, so a lot of these models were made, permutation combinations were tried, and very interestingly, we've used three materials. There is cast iron, which is this pieces, there is brass, and there is mild steel. So it's a combination of three details, and that's what makes this, and this is the process of how this is made. We found one excellent fabricator who's done this job. And we had to drill holes. So this is how the markings had to be very meticulous. And this is how the whole geometry also fits in. Now we did all these things and we inaugurated it. And after 2-3 days, there was a big leak. And all the papers had it covering it, ki Flora Fountain is leaking and all the money has gone down the drains. So we had to really find out where the problem was. So what we found was there was an old pipe which was coming in 9 inches, which you see here, and there was a wall, but this wall was always open. So when we filled the trough, the water used to go away from this to the main drain, and this was a non-functional valve. So we had to practically cut the pipe. You know, the MCGM officers and Kiran, they practically stayed 1 or 2 nights at the site and did it overnight because the awareness and the press was always reporting this thing. So, you know, we were also under pressure what's happening. So you can see the joint which has happened here. We put a new piece and we put a collar and we put a concrete and we've reconnected it. After that, there's not been a single leakage. And this is how the whole thing is back again. It was inaugurated on 24th January by Aditya Thackeray. And this is now the square all complete. So at that time, the part one had been done and now part two, which is all complete now. And what is interesting is it becomes a plaza. It becomes a space for the city to use it. In the afternoons, it's difficult, but in the evenings and in the night, when it's lit and illuminated, it's always good to see people sitting, and we didn't want to give too much comforts where things would be misused. So stainless steel pipes, otherwise people will start sleeping also. And of course, this is how it's lit. And I have to tell you this. What we really, when we visualized the whole project, we had visualized that, you know, on a Saturday, Sunday, when the car park is not used, if we can pave this area also, then at least the city gets a square back on a weekend. The second thing was, if we connect this to Horniman Circle, we also get more additional area which the city requires, which can be used by for cultural activities. So if the whole area is paved with this cobble thing, which when you go abroad in historic areas you have that kind of paving, if we do that, it would be good. Now I don't know whether this will be ever implemented, but always a wishful thinking. Now, having said this, the most difficult part is its maintenance, because you can start seeing the stains and other things happening. Now, till 1 year, which is the contract period where Intact will be helping in restoring it, which will get over soon. But MCGM is planning to float proper tenders and try to maintain it. It's very difficult to maintain it. I can tell you the kind of pressures you require tankers, and if water is scarce for the city, you can't just have water being put here. You'll have criticism on that level. So you have to use, well water and other waters from other sources. That gets algae very fast. And then you have to maintain it well. So we hope it sets a high standard of repairs and maintenance also, because that's, I think that's going to be the most crucial part of it. This is the team, all of us enjoying when Flora was being cleaned, getting selfies and other things clicked. Let me tell you the cost. It's not very large cost. The entire conservation of the Flora Fountain was 1.3 crores, and the entire plaza is 2.4. So 3.7 is what we've spent in the last 3 years. But these are the real heroes, the unsung heroes, the people who've done the 10,000 square feet of cobble path. Yeah, I guess that's the last slide. Thank you.
Can you hear me? Thank you, Vikas. We now open the floor to audience questions. If you have a question, you can raise your hand and somebody from the team will bring your mic.
We didn't need pumps.
Yeah, so someone had very cleverly worked out, because the pump, when we found the alignment, the pipe was coming in the center. It's been done 1.5 feet away from it. So I presume it's done in 1940s, 50s. This is what we assume, because as we went inside, what we found also was of that vintage and that period.
Watson's Hotel is a part of the same UNESCO World Heritage Ensemble as the projects that you discussed. What will happen to its status and the status of the ensemble if the building is demolished or collapses?
Well, it's a matter which is in court, so it will not be fair to give an opinion. But if you're asking, yes, once you have something which gets demolished, which is of significance, the international community and especially the World Heritage Site Office, the Secretariat will, have this thing. They can threaten to delist it or, ask for queries or to do that. That is a possibility, because they've done it for other sites, where there were problems like Angkor Wat, even Hampi, when there was a bridge which was being constructed. So they do raise these kind of questionnaires, and there's an international pressure which gets mounted. So I'm sure that something like that will happen.
During the restoration of the Wellington Fountain, did you happen to chance upon the original inscription? Because usually there would be an inscription.
No, the inscriptions have been cleaned. See, the bas reliefs, four reliefs have inscriptions in them, citing the the laurels of what Duke of Wellington had done. So that is all readable now. They're in Latin.
The original inscription, which when the fountain was inaugurated, who was the engineer? Like what is?
See, what you're talking is, it's not like sculpture or it's not like a painting where someone's inscription.
Because Flora Fountain has.
Yeah, Flora Fountain has, but it has Norman Shaw and that thing is there, but in this nothing was there.
You could get all these things for Can you not use your persuasive powers or whatever to remove the car park from the Wellington Fountain?
I don't know what to say. You have to, I'll tell you, the best thing would be the least bad compromise. You can't work, the least bad compromise is the best thing, otherwise you lose what you have also. If you all, as you bring the awareness and the pressure, I'm sure the MCGM would listen. But everyone wants parking. Otherwise they'll start constructing high-rise buildings saying that there's no parking and please give us parking. You lose the fort area with that. Yes. Yeah, but so that's the reason why if you see the scheme on a Saturday, Sunday, please try experimenting and giving the square back to the city. And then if it works successful, take it inside Hanuman Circle. So that should be this thing. You have the Hanuman Circle, the whole thing from Asiatic Library right till Flora Fountain. There are 5 grade 1 buildings. You have the Hanuman Circle, St. Thomas's Cathedral, Banaji Lingji Agyari, Asiatic Library and Flora Fountain. So 5 grade 1 buildings in a small area like this. Now the only thing is the awareness to build that and to explain it to is a difficult task. Yeah, but then you didn't require a station called DN Road, na? Now you're going to have a station called DN Road. Now you have to understand when a metro station comes in, 100 meter close to metro station, the FSI would be 7. So you'll lose all your heritage.
Mr. Dilawari, I have 2 quick questions. One is, now that the Flora Fountain Plaza is done, could you tell us about some of the new projects you're working on currently? And the second is, do you have a wish list of monuments that you'd like to see go under conservation in Bombay?
Okay, I'm just working on, I'll be working on the Prince of Wales Museum or the Chhatrapati Shivaji Sangrale. The tenders will be floated soon, so that's one project. Wish list, yes, I'm more happy now to restore not landmarks but to restore simple buildings which go otherwise unnoticed. I think it's a reverse phase. When you start your career, you want to do the best of the best buildings which are iconic, but which makes, you know, they're all well protected. But now you really prefer to, and try to do buildings which are simple buildings which otherwise people don't see it. And if you get to restore them and if the people start appreciating that, I think then the movement starts from bottom to top. And I just finished a very beautiful project. If you get a chance, please do go and see. It's an open place, the Ma Hajiani Dargah, which is located at opposite Haji Ali. It's open from 6:30 to 9:30 in the evening. Please do go and have a look.
My question is, the older drawings and the sketches of the original architect. Those had people and animals, and basically the fountains were actually accessible. But
sorry, I didn't get your question. Yeah, what are you saying?
The oldest drawings and the sketches of the fountains had actually the people and the animals in it as part of it.
Yes.
And no fences. But the oldest photographs of these fountains did have fences. So even the 1880s pictures that were seen.
No, in Mulji Jetha you never had a fencing. See, till the time,
but I think,
till the time the fountains were functioning,
they were
meant
open
to be
and
open.
They did actually function the way
so when the piped connection started coming to homes, earlier everyone used to have a well. If you refer an old cadastral survey map, you'll see so many wells which were functional wells which were there. You'll be surprised. Army Navy building has a well. So many other buildings have a well right in their lower basements. So when the pipe connection started, the need of the fountain stopped.
Right.
So then the it became an ornamental thing, and then the neglect started.
Right. But then even in the European pictures, even today, we see that the people go right up to it.
Yeah, but they don't have the kind of population. Like in Wadia Clock Tower, I could have restored the water connection, but you might just find that there's a war happening because of water. Everyone wants to fill free water from there.
Right.
So that also is another thing. Like you make the piaus active, but suppose then people start come, you know, water scarcity is there, they'll start filling water from there. It becomes green. We, as I said to you, in 7 days it becomes green. So that's the problem which we realize. But 4 tankers of water is not easy. If you put chemicals, the birds, the crows come and drink the water. We don't want to. We have put every evening. We have the natural supply of municipal connection which we open, but that's not enough to fill the. We require 15,000 liters. It's open to anyone. No one, no. Gents, ladies, everyone are most welcome there. 6:30 in the morning, and the best time to go is in the evening when the sun is about to set. It's open till 9:30. 6:30 to 9:30.
So I'm Sonali. I'm a fine artist with several exhibitions and awards to my credit. I'm an artist of IMCWIAA. I've done some monumental paintings for them to be gifted to some of their dignitaries. So I'm really interested in knowing the Mulji Jetha Foundation. The fountain which had come to me to be painted. I got the fright of my life because I thought I had to really go and search for the broken sculptures and then make a proper, you know, structure out of it. But I was really surprised, to my pleasant surprise, when I actually took a site visit over there, I could see that it was wonderfully done, sir.
Thank you.
For how many years? How much time did it take?
It was 5 months. It was not a big project.
Okay, but it was done beautifully,
Thank
sir.
You.
I had a real pleasure painting it.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Great talk, Vikas.
Thank you.
Yeah. I wanted to mention to you that where maintenance is concerned, since that's my area of expertise, whoever you may choose, nobody has the know-how of how to maintain. Would you be able to, you know, source that know-how for them?
See,
because otherwise it won't work.
So as this thing, we will request Intact. Rajan is here as a convener. We'll request Intact to look after it because we've realized, if you see the difference,
correct,
when the conservators go, they wear gloves, they have cotton swabs, and they have everything. But if any contractor goes, you can see the difference. It's taken us 2 years to clean, 6 months to clean Flora Fountain.
Right.
Whereas VT, the whole work has got over in 3 months or 6 months, including all sculptures and everything. So that's the difference. So we are aware of it. We are drafting a thing where we are insisting a conservator to be there in it. It would be ideal if Intact can look after it. If Intact doesn't look after it or someone else, then we'll have to put a condition of having a conservator in it. But there are a couple of things. Since you're into maintenance, you'll realize someone else to also take the responsibility of filling the water, because everything cannot be. Then security comes in. Because at the moment the contractor was there, now once we move out, again it's open to everyone, and there's not a single thing for security.
But those are not very difficult things to manage, but the main thing would be the
right
procedure.
Yes, so there are do's and don'ts written in the tender document.
Okay.
Not, and we just hope and pray it never gets painted again.
Okay.
That's the last thing, because I did the ANZ Grindlays Bank. By the time it became Standard Chartered, you again had the paint back.
The Flora Fountain, it seems that the submersible pump which was there, according to you, how much old that pump was? And was it in working condition?
It was in working condition. And see, what happened is, by the time the other contractor came into place to do the surrounding area, he bought a JCB. So with the JCB, that you know, the old pipe which was connecting got this thing. Now, having you've raised a very important question. Now, everyone wants to see water coming 24/7 from Flora Fountain. But you have to understand, there is a pump working, and it can work till particular hours. You need to give a break to it. And very interestingly, it's a 5 horsepower pump. 7.5, but we're using it. Ideally, we should have called for a 5. The idea is, we want to regulate the flow, because if the water comes more forcefully, then it falls onto the sculptures. Now, the electrical consultant has warned us that don't control the water valve much, because the pump will get this thing. So it's again a balance, that you want the water also to flow properly, and you don't want this. So it's not very easy. As I said to you, we've done this, but we've realized the difficulties in maintaining such things.
But sir,
it's not a question of second pump. It's not like air. See, the question, it's not like air condition. We can do that, but it's very complicated. 2 sources of water and pipes, it's not like, it's not so easy, and you have the existing system already there. I know, but so what we've done is, we are going to put a timer switch. We'll put it on for 4 hours in the morning and 4 hours in the evening, and we'll keep it shut. So, I hope a maintenance person comes into place, because then things will fall in an order.
Sir, another query is that when you were working on the plumbing system, and the existing, all those were in metals, especially I think that must be copper or either metal really. But right now also, instead of using plastic as an option, you know, so that it doesn't corrode, I think I saw more of the pics in which plumbing was of CI, cast iron. So what, according to you,
we've just done one bend which is connected. Otherwise, we've not touched anything, at least in Flora Fountain. Yeah, in Mulji Jetha Fountain, we've used the sea quality, this thing. Yes, because we were connecting it to the original one. So you have to understand, the main thing which is going is in cast iron, which is in mild steel, the old 9 inches pipe. So you have to understand, I can't be doing research and development at a cost of a contractor already appointed. We have to get the project executed, and I have to see it get completed.
Yes.
We've tried our best to do, and these are things after 10, it's an open plumbing. If something goes wrong, someone can change it after 10 years, 15 years.
Exactly, sir. You know, that was my query, that, you know, for long run, you know, the solution is
at the moment Kalagoda is maintaining it for 10 years. After 10 years, you don't know what happens.
Exactly, sir.
There is a building on road which is unique construction. It's got a stainless or a steel support, and it is currently in danger of collapse. It's going to cost a fortune, I'm told. I think the municipality has decided not to do it. What can be done about that?
That's the Esplanade mansion which you are talking about. It's a matter in court. I can just tell you, as a conservation architect, there is a situation in which it's been neglected for so long that it's reached that stage because of rent control. And because now, the best thing is, for the last 30 years we have conservation which has been introduced since 1995, but there has been no proactive incentives given to any of the heritage things. So it becomes a liability to be graded as a heritage, because neither are you getting any funding, neither are you discouraging redevelopment, neither are you giving funds for repairs. So we are in a situation where I say and I compare that you have set up an hospital, you have an ICU, but there's no oxygen. So what we need to do is to create and get awareness of the oxygen which is required, because if you discourage redevelopment at least, or don't give higher FSI, at least for the heritage areas, and rest of the areas you can do it. Or if you want to do also, have a planned approach, because what we find is many things are ad hoc. I wish the building is can be saved. Now you require, because it's a very complicated multi-tenanted complicated case in terms of legal ownership and other things. It's worth, of course, everyone knows about it. It's worth saving, and everyone wants to save it. Everyone wants to save it also. You have a PIL which has been registered by Intact Mumbai chapter. Well, all this will emerge once you go into the details, because everyone, you have to study the details of it. So I'm sure an expert committee would be set up, or something would happen. I don't know. I can't comment on it.
Is Bam, this will just have to be the last question.
Matters so much to all of us in the city that the Esplanade Hotel should be saved, and because it is such a unique structure. I think the Bombay Municipal Corporation should take it up as a challenge and say that we've got a conservation architect who can do the most incredible things he's shown us from the work he's done. Take it as a challenge, give it to Vikas, and say, everyone's saying it should be brought down. Give it as a challenge and say, can you do it, Vikas? Can you and your team, and with all the support that the city can offer?
It requires a good structural engineer to understand it.
Of course.
And
you work not just alone, you work with a
I think on that note, we'll have to close the evening. Thank you all so much for being here. And thank you, Vikas, for treating us to this fantastic lecture, and also for the fabulous work that you've been doing.